Hello and welcome to the Digital Insight, the technology, procurement and supply chain podcast that delivers valuable C-level perspective into the core issues surrounding business transformation and digital disruption. Each episode will bring you the most inspiring executive insights from those who are leading transformation strategies within the world's biggest and best known companies. The Digital Insight. Disrupt. Transform. Evolve.
Welcome to the Digital Insight, the official podcast series for CPO Strategy and Interface Magazines. My name is Dale, and today I'm joined by Jeremy Bowley of Insider Pro, a company that orchestrates supply chains and operations to improve profitability, remove constraints to growth, and eliminate risks. In this episode, I ask Jeremy if there's any truth to the notion that procurement has an image problem. We also take a look at what strategic procurement actually means and how that's changing thanks to the COVID-19 pandemic. I also put him on the spot as I ask him, in this time where we're all reflecting on how we can change and improve the function for the better, what would be the one permanent change that he'd make if he had the power to do so? So, Jeremy, welcome to the show.
Hi, Dale. Good to be on.
I'm excited to talk to you today. So just as a means so that, hey, I can get to know you a little bit better, but also our listeners can find out, you know, who you are and why we're speaking to you today. Can you give me a bit of a snapshot as to your career journey, obviously, particularly in that procurement space, to where you find yourself today?
Okay, yeah, sure, no problem. I've been in procurement for 20 years, scarily. I started out, I think like most people did, in a sort of buying almost graduate scheme role in essentially a water company. So that's where I started. I'll leap forward to today. So now I run a boutique procurement consultancy. We're just shy of 20 people. And we specialize in what we call enterprise value creation. So primarily private equity backed businesses who want to maximize the value of their business. We help them do that through procurement. And it's been an interesting journey from quasi public sector water company all the way through to working for some pretty cool private equity growth businesses, which is really now my specialism.
Yeah, and then we'll dive a little deeper into obviously the company a little bit later, but just sticking with then your procurement perspective, a lot of people come on this show and talk to me on a daily basis, and one of the things that comes up a lot is that there's something of an image problem with procurement, in that it's got this kind of traditional, I don't want to say boring, but some people do say kind of a boring perspective, that it's an office at the end of the hall that cashes the checks or that orders something in for the business, and that's all that matters. And the real juicy stuff, the real interesting stuff in a business, is in the different business areas. And one person in particular said that they're trying to fix that. They're trying to make procurement cool because he's a procurement professional and he believes it's cool. Looking at your experience of it, both obviously more recently now, but even back in your earlier days, what's your view on that? What's your view in terms of how is procurement becoming a different beast in businesses?
I think we definitely have an image problem. It is distinctly uncool. If you go to a graduate fair at university, people will gravitate towards sales, marketing, HR, to a degree accountancy in itself, which is not the most exciting thing. I say, people, do you want to add up for a living and do spreadsheets? I think they'll probably say no. But what those professions offer is the ability to influence and to have impact. And I think what we're starting to see, and it's been a long journey, 20, 30 years probably, is procurement is starting to get its mind around how it delivers impact. But there are still those of us, even in the profession, who would describe it as going shopping for a living. And I think one of the reasons that we really struggle as a profession is we've not got very good at describing the impact that we can have to other people. Then that feeds through to our ability to attract talent, our ability to influence the organization, our ability to have make a big difference at a strategic level.
And this is not a difficult question, although you might say it's difficult, but obviously I'm going to challenge you on it. But as a procurement professional, then, if you were to speak to me and I was a graduate, like I say, or I was just sort of asking, well, why is procurement, why should I care about procurement more than, any other business area? What would be your kind of quick fire way of, at least introducing to me of the true value and the importance and even the the significance and enjoyment of procurement?
For me, procurement is all about coordinating collaboration between organizations. And that's way more challenging and exciting than, say, just doing it within a business. So if you go into a business and go into a normal functional role, generally speaking, most of your effort is going to be around how do I coordinate the efforts of the people within my business. What procurement allows you to do, this is the exciting bit, and even at a junior level, you know, even in your first job, it allows you to go and say, okay, I want to try and help a much broader group of people collaborate and drive value. So you know, in a junior role in procurement, you're going to get to speak to, interface with, you know, managing directors, sales directors, operations directors, COOs, all those sorts of people of your supply chain. And then your job is to coordinate those to deliver value for your company. If you think about that and saying, you know, what's my ability to make a, you know, to use a Steve Jobism, I think it's a Steve Jobism, and make a dent in the universe, it's huge. I can't think of another function that offers that at such an early level. Of course, the rub being, we don't really talk about it like that, and we don't really tell anybody about that. So we underplay our ability to have an enormous impact. And you know, probably to your previous question, that's probably why we've got a bit of an image problem. I don't think we kind of back ourselves enough. I struggle to find another function which has that enormous impact, particularly at a sort of, you know, in an entry level.
Yeah. And it's interesting because, you know, you yourself, you said, like, you know that it's exciting. You know about this impact, but you also admit that as a profession, you're kind of guilty of, yeah, underplaying that importance. And, you know, obviously there's no right or wrong answer. There's no one way that fixes everything. But what's kind of a key to overcoming that, to being able to confidently stand in front of like a COO and a different leadership position and actually say, look, I'm not over egging what we do. We really do have a huge impact, rather than that approach of, yeah, I suppose we do have a bit of an impact because you know, it's kind of inherently spent all these years underplaying it. So to sort of sum up that rambly question, what do you think is key to kind of changing that conversation and changing that drive?
I think it's down to being able to demonstrate the impact that we have and being honest with the business about it. So there's an authenticity that sits behind this. So, you know, you hear it all the time, don't you? Procurement think there's lots of savings here, or procurement think there's lots of value, or procurement think they're really, really helping. But really, they're just a kind of postbox for the exercise. And I think, you know, it comes back to what is our role, and therefore how do we articulate it? You know, if our role is to look into the organization and say, what does the organization need? And maybe to help resolve some of the conflicts, because different people in the business will want different stuff depending on which function they're within. And then to look outward into the world and say, okay, how do we best satisfy that need? If we start to talk about it in those terms, it becomes a strategic conversation. What that means, though, is that we need to take ourselves away from the kind of stuff that's safe and comfortable. You know, it's like, let's have a conversation about taking cost out of stationery. That's not a strategic conversation. If we put our effort and our talk into those things, whilst we might need to do them, right, we're never gonna rise out of very, very tactical conversations. And I hear it all the time. You know, I hear people talk about strategic procurement, and it is like the least strategic thing you've ever heard. They say, you know what we're going to do? We're going to save money on toilet cleaning. But we're going to do a strategic procurement process for it. And you go, I'm not being funny, guys. That's not strategic. You know, what we're looking for is opportunities for us to make a real difference to the business model. So, for example, if you were to say, through my supply chain strategy, I'm able to build such strong relationships with my suppliers that represents a massive barrier to our competitors getting their hands around that supply chain or replicating that supply chain, and therefore that delivers X or Y in our business plan or proposition, that's strategic. And we've got to spend the time talking about that, because until we do, we are going to be a back office function, and probably rightly so.
And how much is a two-way street? So obviously, as the procurement professional, as the supply chain guy, you know, you are going to go out and try and have those conversations and try and change that discourse. But how much of it also has to come from the other business areas, the leaders? How much do they have to sort of meet you in the middle? Because there's always that risk, because you go all that way, and then, you know, we'll use a bridge as an example. If you go to the side of that, do and have the conversation, then you walk away, they've not moved. It's you who's done all the moving. So how much of it has to be that kind of meeting in the middle, if that makes sense?
Yeah, I mean, you've got to have people who are open to the conversation. So you've definitely got to be in a business that's functional, that's working. If you're in completely dysfunctional business where there's just no conversation, of course, you know, it's going to be pretty much impossible. But what I'd say is that's not most organizations. Most organizations are, you know, by virtue of the fact that they're trading and being profitable and throwing off cash, then they're going to work. You know, they're going to have their problems, but they're going to be open to anything that delivers real value. So if you can demonstrate that through how you orchestrate supply chain, you can grow sales, you can improve consistency, you can reduce risk, you can increase cash flow, you can improve profitability, you can take away some of the barriers that stop the organization growing, then it is not a difficult conversation to get people to come across the bridge towards you. Because ultimately, the C-suite is motivated by, and certainly in our world, but I think this is true of all organizations, by the value that it can create. So by definition, you become part of the solution. And if you turn up to any CFO, CEO, and say, hey, look, I think I can make the organization's share price go up by 10%. And if you can do that credibly, you will get traction. There's absolutely no question about it. The trick is, of course, to do that credibly and have something that really does make a difference.
And on a similar note then, what are your thoughts on one of the most, and I'll hold my hands up and say this is me speaking personally here, speaking to a number of procurement people over the last few years now. What's your thoughts to that kind of most overused phrase of procurement now has a seat at the table? You know, a lot of people like to say that. A lot of people find that quite an interesting thing to sort of say, is like this to represent this huge shift in procurement. But what does that actually mean? Like, you know, what does that mean for not just you as the procurement guy, but obviously the wider business to have that seat at the table?
It's interesting. So I hear that a lot. You know, procurement deserves a seat at the table is the kind of context that often I hear that in. And my response to that is always pretty much the same. And I say, well, you know, does it deserve it? You know, so if procurement is adding strategic value, it deserves that seat at the table, probably a physical seat at the board table. If procurement isn't doing that and it's just doing tactical work, just delivering, you know, slightly better prices or, you know, managing day-to-day supplier relationships, but not really elevating them and creating, you know, extra value for the customer or creating barriers to entry for the competition or locking in value at an enterprise level, it doesn't deserve a seat at the table. And I'm sad to say that that's probably true in sort of 8 out of 10 companies where, you know, procurement isn't something that they need to be, that they A, potentially need to be good at, or B, can be good at, because, you know, the nature of the way that they manage themselves. And it frustrates me intensely because it just kind of sounds like we're moaning. It's almost as if to say, oh, I deserve a seat at the table. Well, you know, go and earn it. Because if I'm looking around that board table as a CEO, I'm looking at each of those people, each of those posts, each of those functional roles, and I'm saying, sales, how does that add strategic value? Finance, how does that add strategic value? Marketing, how does that add strategic value? And if I can't respond to that with a clear demonstration of adding proper strategic value, then I don't deserve that seat at the table. And let's be clear, right? Sending out a, you know, tender or following a, you know, 7-step sourcing process, that's not strategic. It's not moving the organization fundamentally forward. It might be doing a good job, which is very valuable and needs to be done, but it's not strategic. And unless you are genuinely adding value to the enterprise at a fundamental level, then we definitely do not deserve that seat. We need to work hard for that.
Yeah. And, you know, you're talking about that kind of strategic value. You're talking about, really propelling and driving a company's growth. But obviously, in the most sort of zooming out, in the most kind of layman terms, procurement mostly gets associated with looking at the bottom line. It's looking at that cash flow, as you mentioned earlier. And obviously now then, the conversations are around highlighting procurement's role in strategic value, in driving growth and in innovation, you know, these lovely words that people say, but there's also, again, still that responsibility to look at that bottom line, to, in effect, save money, you know, and that sort of thing. How much of that is a balancing act? That no matter, yes, the conversations have moved forward and now procurement has been given a chance to show off and say, look, what more we can do than just save money. But at the end of the day, it still has to save money. So how is that balancing act unfolding? How difficult is it?
Well, it depends, I guess, on the business that you're in. But what I would definitely say is that, you know, the sort of classic adding savings, you know, sort of basic EBITDA through things costing less, you know, that's the day job, right? That is the reason that you exist at a base level. That's kind of like ticket to the party stuff. The next level's up, and that's not strategic. You know, just adding slightly more run rate on EBITDA is not strategic. So what we're well placed now to do is uplift other bits of the organization, because what's quite exciting is as the world kind of changes and there are more small organizations and there's more innovation out there when you look, we've got more of an opportunity to bring those things into play. So you've got to do both. You've got to satisfy the day job or the basic things, almost the hygiene factors. The EBITDA is like, and savings is almost hygiene factors. In most cases, there will be exceptions to that, but in most cases that'll be the case. All the other stuff is that strategic value. So if you're going out there and saying, look, actually, you know, it takes us 5 days to get a product to customers, and there's a market price for the product that we get to customers, but I think we can do it in three by having a different approach to how we produce or distribute our products, then that becomes strategic if that factor is a deciding factor in where consumers choose to shop. And it's those sorts of things that we've got to work on. So I always think the challenge for procurement is to yes, deliver the basics, but then to start thinking in system terms. And it's shifting our thinking away from tactical and almost a tick box exercise of, you know, we've done a tender and they've passed all of our tests and I've read their accounts, I've done all the basic stuff, and that's, you know, that's okay. It needs to be done. But we need to shift into systems thinking now, and how do we manage the ecosystem of potential that is out there, which is huge and changing. And that is the exciting piece that we've got to get our minds around. So yes, you have to do both. And I guess it depends on first your organization's appetite and need to be good at procurement. Not all organizations need to be good at procurement. And secondly, it depends on your appetite to go and do more. And the best news is this: there is more opportunity out there now than there has ever been.
Which leads me quite nicely then. Is that because of COVID, or is that, you know, regardless of COVID? Like, we try our best not to focus too much on, obviously, well, COVID's going to impact this and COVID's going to impact that. But it's very clear that COVID has definitely allowed people to realize and recognize procurement a little differently than it ever had before. And again, looking at that balancing act and what we've just been talking about, has it made it easier? Has it made it harder? What has that kind of general impact been of COVID on that procurement conversation?
In lots of ways. I like to think about COVID as being an accelerant. So COVID really has probably just accelerated or amplified all the things that were probably going to happen anyway. So, you know, the suppliers in which we took too much risk as a profession and we let stocks run too thin got caught out by COVID, by the logistical challenges, by factories shutting down, by borders closing, all those sorts of things. And they got caught short. Those things would have probably happened anyway. They just wouldn't have happened all at the same time. And it would have been slightly less stressful, I guess. But those weaknesses would have played out in the supply chain over time anyway. And all COVID did was just make that happen quickly and altogether. You know, COVID will shake out, and it's a blunt instrument, but it will shake out the companies that weren't going to make it. So rather than going bust over 5 years, they went bust over 5 months. You know, but those were companies which were not going to carry industry forward in most instances. Now, you know, people, I'm sure they will say, but there's an exception over here, and there will be no doubt about it. But it's one of those events that's actually kind of good news in many ways, because A, yes, we've got up the list of priorities because all of a sudden we've realized that not having stuff is really important. You know, all of a sudden we've realized that that some of the suppliers who we thought were in good shape were not in good shape, and actually our risks were much bigger than we thought they were. So there's a big sort of reevaluation. And in the sort of rebuild, I guess, we've now got a real chance to shape things, which is actually really exciting. So yes, I think it probably amplifies where we were heading anyway. We just got there a couple of years faster.
So looking then at InsiderPro then, it's looking at you and your business and where you are right now. Elevator pitch is another one that people like to say. give me the rundown as to exactly what is Insider Pro, what does it do, what is its market, what's its value proposition, why do we need a business like Insider Pro in procurement?
So we help businesses build their enterprise value, so effectively be worth more. Largely, we do that with mid-cap businesses. So that's businesses, you know, arguably worth less than £1 billion turnover terms, and probably more than sort of 50 million. And if you want to get to places faster, if you want to get to a higher valuation for your business faster, that's what we do. So it's quite niche in that respect. We focus almost exclusively on growth businesses. So businesses that want to go and do something that that's different, that are growing, that are gaining market share. That's really what we're after. We don't tend to work with the very large sort of super blue chip corporates. We tend to work with the sort of challenger brands, the upstarts, the people who are going places. So that's what we do. And what we help organizations do is firstly look internally and say, what do we actually need in order to grow? And that's different in every business. And then we help them look back out to the supply chain and say, okay, what's the best way of doing that? So I guess we sort of sit in almost a space between procurement and sort of operations in many respects, because our role is to say, well, what's the right strategy? How is that playing out in terms of business needs and therefore into the customer, the business's customer proposition? And then how is that best satisfied? Is that, you know, how much stuff do we make? How much stuff do we buy? How do we buy it? Where does innovation happen? So a lot of the work we do is really helping that larger group of stakeholders, and both internally and externally, so that's the people in the functions and in the supply chain, the potential supply chain, collaborate for more value. And that's the bit that's super exciting, because if you work in an organization with, you know, as I did some time ago, with a couple of thousand people, then, and you're sort of taking a functional view, you're leveraging a couple of thousand people's brains. We had in excess of 50,000 people in our suppliers and supply chain, and probably more than that. And I'd much rather leverage 50,000 people's brain power than, you know, than a couple of thousand. And I think that's what's exciting. So that's what we do. We love doing it. A lot of the businesses that we work with, we're able to significantly uplift their valuation and therefore their EBITDA, their cash flow, and reduce their risk profile. And we do that super quick. So for most of our businesses that we work with, they're seeing real tangible improvements in usually something like 90 days, which, you know, for procurement, is not bad.
to put it lightly, that's not bad at all.
Yeah, it's funny. We struggle a bit with almost like the, it's almost too good to be true. It's almost like, how do you do that? But here's the thing, is what, you know, we do it as a profession in our business, and you know, we're good at it. But for most people, for most procurement people, actually they could do a lot of that themselves. And that's what's quite exciting, because you are sitting on a huge amount of opportunity if your eyes are open to it.
Looking then again at COVID, obviously, and what we've just been talking about, how those conversations have changed, about the impact, about how it's actually quite exciting, specifically from an Insider Pro perspective then, looking at the people you've been speaking to and working with, and even, you know, existing and future potential, you know, people you're going to be working with, how have the conversations changed there? How are you seeing a difference in the way that organizations and businesses are talking to you about what you can do for them?
There's more market out there, for sure. I don't think I've ever been so busy on the sales front. You know, we get more calls now. So that's really quite exciting. So there's definitely more demand out there for businesses that are able now to use COVID and all the things, all the challenges that it creates, as a platform for accelerating change. So it's been good for us. We work with growth businesses. Most of them, I'd say, out of our customers, I don't know, maybe 8, 9 out of 10, that sort of scale, have done more, which is fab. So they've said, actually, yeah, this is a good opportunity. We're going to have reduced pressure from the operational line. They went through that containment phase in the first 6-8 weeks, and they kind of got everything stabilized. And then they had a bit of space, and they went, okay, we now need to set up and start working on the business that we really want to own. Because for any leadership team, it's all the day job that gets in the way of fundamentally changing the business. So we had great conversations about, okay, right, should we be doing this activity? So we've done this for years and years and years. You know, is it right that we do this? Could the supply chain do this better? In fact, there are some things that supply chains are doing. Could we do it better? And we've been involved in a lot of that during the COVID period. And what's exciting is the organizations that we've been working with in terms of their run rate, EBITDA, their cash flow, their capability of doing things consistently and better for customers, that's improved. So there'll be a number of organizations that have definitely upped their game during the COVID period. And that's been the change, because it's been less about, from at least our customers, it's been less about sort of the day-to-day and more about, okay, how do I fundamentally change this business model and make things better for the long term? And that's what's been great and exciting.
And not just limited to obviously what's happening right now and with COVID, but just generally over the time since Insider Pro has been a business, since you've been operating, I'm always intrigued to explore the idea that, because obviously, as you know, you have an approach, you have experience, you have a process that you as a business follow that works, it's proven to work, and you've got, many successes. You can turn around and say, well, look, this proves that what we've done and how we've worked with companies is very successful. But whenever I speak to certain people in procurement and they talk about bringing outside people in or outside consultants or that sort of thing in, there's a bit of a, I don't want to say a clash, but like a sort of a, there's kind of a need to be on both sides, a little bit of humility, so that what I'm trying to say is, how have you had to change your approach, again, not just with COVID, but just over the years, so that you don't, A, sit still and say, well, look, our way is the highway, find someone else if you have to, but that you've evolved as well. So that, as you every time you work with a new client and even existing clients, it's fluid, it evolves together, and not just, well, this is the only way we know that works, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I think the first thing is there's no one way to do things. There's more than one way to get there, and you've got to find the way that's right for the organization. So you hear an awful lot about best practice, and I've even written about best practice myself, and I sort of hate that. So we don't ever come with a, this is a best practice for, buying, fleet or for your approach to contract manufacturing. It's like, in our minds, there's absolutely no best practice whatsoever. What there is some things that work and some really good ideas, and what you've got to find is what's the organization's next practice. I guess that's where the conversation's evolved. And I suppose when we started out, we probably were a bit guilty of going, this is the way to do it because we know it works. And it was true. Like, we had done it and it had worked and there were some great results. But as we've learned more and more about our customers, and I've now worked with more than 100 companies in my time, we've got to a place where we're going, okay, but what's the next thing that's right for you? Because if you write, a manual for best practice procurement based on the experiences of ABC Fortune 500 organization, and then you try and apply that to a £200 million growth business, in Wigan, then you get, it's never going to work. You've got to find the practical next steps that are going to make real difference to that business's ability to continue to grow. And that's going to evolve with time. So I think that's what we've got better at, and where the conversation's changed. We've started to understand how we better service the things that organization needs next, rather than this kind of mythical idea of what's best.
And looking at then Insider Pro again from a just zooming out perspective, obviously, it says on your website, because I've obviously been reading about business, that you have a mission to create £5 billion enterprise value for UK businesses by 2030. Now, I'm not going to ask you and say, how close are you to that margin or anything like that? But what I mean is, just generally, looking at the trajectory, looking at the journey so far and as to where we are right now, is that still something, is that still an achievable target, do you feel? And what?
Yes, no question.
And what has been kind of...
In short.
I'm glad to hear it. But what has been key to success? Key to, again, there's no one right way, of course, you've just said that, but what, if you could take one thing away from the journey so far, what would you say has been a kind of a through line, which is, you would say, well, that's kind of what's been crucial to us?
Speed, the ability to get stuff done quickly, because organizations are inherently short-termist in their nature, so that they need benefits now, and that's really helped us. And it's helped us in a sort of counterintuitive way. So I will spend most of my time talking to people about playing the long game. But in order to get to the long game, you've got to win in the short term. I've had this conversation with many chief executives and even investors to say, yeah, it's great having a fantastic business in 5 years, but you've got to be there in 5 years to be that fantastic business. And you've got to generate the funds and the cash flow and all those sorts of things to get there. And I think that's been our sort of learning and realization, which is you've got to build yourself up to it. And therefore, that means taking some wins on the way. People often talk about that as low hanging fruit. I sort of hate that phrase. But what I would say is, you know, we've built momentum because we can demonstrate what we can do very, very quickly. Once we've done that, we get to do some of the longer term stuff. And what I tend to find is customers building confidence and they're prepared to do more, be more disruptive, get more excited and realize what really can be achieved. And that has been the trajectory of, I think, pretty much all of our accounts. So we've done more with those customers, but also, you know, other people hear about it. And when other people hear about the business grows, which has been really good.
Not to sort of say, well, tell me what's gone wrong, because I'm not in the business of asking what's gone wrong, but more so, obviously, throughout that time, you've achieved some great successes, but there are going to have been things that haven't quite worked out. There's going to be, we'll use the word mistakes, there's going to be things that have just sort of completely been wrong. How important is it to recognize and admit that that's happened, that you have had, you know, conversations, clients, you know, things have just not gone to plan, and you've had to hold your hands up, both yourselves and as the businesses you've worked with, and say, I'm sorry, this has not gone right. Let's work to find a solution that will, you know, be successful.
Yeah, I mean, I believe that anybody who tells you they don't get things wrong is a fantasist and is probably in denial. So yeah, we've made loads of mistakes, but I think each of those mistakes has helped us learn. So we've gone from, I would say we've got three times faster at the work we do now, which is good. And we've only got there by looking back at our process and going, hey, why did that go wrong? Or why did that take so long? Or why didn't that work? So yeah, we've got a whole background of mistakes, issues, problems, stuff that we didn't expect. And quite often I end up saying, you know, in the sort of process of talking to customers, you know, when you're buying external support, what you're actually buying is all the mistakes and therefore all the things that you've learned to do better next time, or things that you say, actually, let's not do that again, because do you remember when that didn't work out? So we've had plenty of those and they've come at every step. So we've hired the wrong people at times. We've treated people in the wrong way. We have focused on the wrong things. We have made our processes too convoluted. We have at times pushed ourselves into a sort of almost a too constrictive regime. We've done all of those things, and I don't regret any of them, because they've helped us become the business that we are today. So our performance now, I feel, is really very, very good, and it will get better. But it's only that good because we've made those mistakes. And I can't think of an area in our business where we haven't made a mistake. I suppose the game here is to make mistakes, learn from them. Don't repeat them, but get it right ultimately where it counts. Unfortunately, we've been able to do that.
Yeah. My final question for you then is a bit of a softball. I don't think it's a bit of a softball at all, but it's one that I like to ask everybody, because I'm always intrigued. No, I've never had the same answer twice. And it would be, and normally I ask about what is a secret success and that sort of thing, but actually, you know, with COVID and what's happening right now, it's forcing a lot of people to be a bit more reflective, to look back, look inwards and examine where they may have been thinking they've been going, you know, things have been right for so many years. Actually, this might have made you realize, but we could still be better. If you could change one thing, if there was one permanent change that you were in charge of, you know, in terms of procurement and supply chain, it could be a thing that you dislike, or a thing that just, you know, is a norm that really shouldn't be a norm. What would be the one change you could make if you were given the power to do so?
Oh, blimey, Dale, that's a tremendous question. With the one change. Okay, I'm gonna channel an economist from the 1970s and say, it's targets. That's what I would change. So there's back in the 1970s, and there's an economist called Goodhart who gave rise to something called Goodhart's Law. And it basically says that anything, as soon as you make a measure a target, it ceases to be a good measure, because essentially people start to game the system. So the one thing I'd like to see the end of is like things like savings targets or improvement targets or targets for you know, sort of KPI improvement. It just drives me to distraction, because all it does is force us to change the definitions of what success looks like. And we sort of create, And if you want to do some more reading, if you search for John Seddon on Wikipedia, and he'll talk about failure demand. It just drives in failure demand, and that can be as big as 40 to 60% of unneeded spend, demands, time wasted, all those sorts of things. I find that just incredibly distracting. It's clear and obvious to most of us where the value is. Yes, we need things that are measures that help us say, are we on target, as in, are we going to arrive at the right destination? But the setting of arbitrary targets, which our industry is absolutely awash with, is well-intentioned, but entirely counterproductive the vast majority of the time. There may be the odd exception where it can work, but most of the time, if you do stuff like target people on savings, or, you know, even once I saw a target for innovation, you must have 27% innovation this month. I was thinking, well, how do you measure that? Like, what is that? That's just box ticking. So that would be for me, for sure. I'm all for measures. I love data. I think that's really important. But we must be very, very careful not to make those into targets. So if I could change that tomorrow, we'd do that, and we'd have more impact. We'd do that faster, and the world would be a much more authentic and fun place.
Thank you for listening to the Digital Insight Podcast in association with theinterface.net and cpostrategy.com. The Digital Insight is brought to you by B2E Media Limited. We hope you enjoyed this episode. Please remember to subscribe, rate, and review. And don't forget to check out our podcast archive at www.b2e-media.com/thedigitalinsight.